All right, we're going to go to Psalm 113 this morning, just a few verses. I invite you to follow along in the church Bible or in your own Bible. Continuing on in our series on worship, week 5 today. Praise the Lord. It begins. Praise, O servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. We read that phrase many places in the Psalms, or something like it. Praise the name of the Lord, let the name of the Lord be praised. And we sometimes say it in the church, but do you ever think about what it means? I mean, why are we told to do that? Why do we say that? You know, if you think about it, it's kind of a strange thing to say. I mean, if you did something really nice for somebody and they wanted to thank you for what you'd done and they came up to you and said, you know, I just really want to thank your name for what you did for me. It was really nice. You're such a wonderful name. We'd kind of look at them like, what? You know, you weirdo? Whatever. But why does Scripture give so much emphasis to the name of the Lord? What's so important about God's name? Well, the answer to that can really only be found in the meaning of the names, and we'll talk about some of them today. I use the plural there because, as most of you know, God is given many, many different names throughout the Scriptures. One research tool that I use says that there are 117 names for Jesus in the Bible. There are 16 names for God the Father, and there's at least 13 names for God the Holy Spirit. I have a book here by Herbert Lockyer as part of the All series. There's lots of books in this series, but this one is All the Divine Names in the Bible, and it's like 360 pages chocked full of study and research and explanation about all of the names of God to be found in the Word. The study of names can really be pretty fascinating, pretty interesting, and instructive. There have been stories told throughout the years about the great French emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, the little guy who had a bad arm, I guess, or something. Some of those jokes, or some of those stories, are jokes, and some of them are pretty sobering historical accounts. This one I thought was a little bit amusing. There's a story of a man who meets Napoleon at a party that's being held somewhere in the kingdom, and this guy, who just happens to be drunk, I guess he's been too long at the party, comes up to the emperor and slurs out the words, "Oh, emperor, I am so pleased to meet you because you and I have the same name." Now, Bonaparte had heard about this man's reputation, his bad character, and now he could kind of see it and smell it for himself right in front of him, and he says to the man, "Well, I suggest that you either change our name, or that you either live up to our name, or you change it." And I'm sure that was a poignant moment for that man. But I wonder, if we were to meet Jesus Christ face to face, and he were to say to us, "Christian, either live up to my name or change it," what would you say? Acts 11:26 says that the disciples of Jesus were first called Christians at a little church in Antioch in Asia Minor. We've been using that name for ourselves ever since, but the name Christian literally means little Christ. Now, how does that strike you? Do you find it the least bit unsettling or the least bit convicting that as a follower of Jesus, you should be called little Christ? I mean, does our conduct, does our attitude befit the name, or does it kind of betray the name? According to the name, when people see how we are living, they should think, "Wow, you are just like Christ." That's what they should think. We need to live up to the name if we call ourselves Christian. People attending a school sometimes adopt the school mascot name or the sports team name for themselves, maybe as a means of identifying themselves, but also rooting for their team. You know, I was a Shelby Tiger when I graduated from high school up north here. But, you know, I thought about it. We don't holler in the stands, "Go football team," or "Come on, basketball team." We holler, "Go Rockets," right? Or "Come on, Warriors," or whatever the school happens to be. We urge those players to live up to the name that they bear, the name that they have attached themselves with, to be the best that they can be. Maybe you've heard this before, but in Eastern and in Middle Eastern cultures, names carry a far greater significance than what they do for us here in the West. In the Middle East, parents don't usually name their children according to the sound of the name or how it fits with the last name or whether it somehow honors or reminds them of another member of the family. None of that. They usually choose names that represent what they hope or they believe their child will become. So in biblical times, names were often tied to the parents' perceptions, or maybe I should say their aspirations for their child's character and their child's personality. And remember that in Bible times, they didn't choose the child's name until the eighth day. Remember the dedication? They would bring them to the temple, and then the name would be declared on the eighth day. So they had a whole week to get to know this child and kind of sense what their personality is, and maybe they would change the name based on kind of the personality of the child that they sense. They often chose noble and virtuous names because they wanted their children to grow up to be noble, virtuous people, like a self-fulfilling prophecy. Now, because names have great meaning, it's very significant when we see in the Bible that some people's names are actually changed by God to some other name. For example, Abram was renamed Abraham. Jacob was renamed Israel. Cephas was renamed Peter. Saul renamed Paul. I mean, those are just a few examples that I can think of in the Bible. These men had their names changed because God changed their lives. God gave them a whole new identity, a whole new calling, a whole new purpose in their life. Now, by this time, you might be thinking, you know, I thought we were talking about worship. I thought we were doing a worship series. You know, what does any of this have to do with worship? Well, it really has a lot to do with worship. On some Sunday morning, you might come into this church or maybe some other church and hear a song that goes like this. "We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord." Anybody ever heard that song? Yeah, okay, yeah. That song actually comes directly out of the scriptures. Do you know what a sacrifice of praise is? Hebrews 13:15 tells us, "Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually," not just on Sunday morning, "let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise." What's that? It's the fruit of lips that confess his name. So a sacrifice of praise is, at least in part, a confession of the names of the Lord. A sacrifice of praise is speaking and it's singing God's names in relationship to our own lives. And so we sing songs like, "His name is wonderful. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is he." And we sing, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower." And all kinds of songs will start coming into your head now that I've deposited the idea of how much we sing and speak the names of the Lord. When we do that before others, as we do here on Sunday morning, it declares to them that we have put our hope and our trust, our faith in this God who is of these many names. Most of all, though, we do it for God. We do it as an offering of thanks because he's demonstrated his power, his love, his goodness, all of that in our lives. God loves to hear his name declared and confessed and extolled and sung. He loves to hear his name. We might compare it to a father or a mother who, for the first time, hears their toddler say, "Dada," or "Mama." or whatever. And grandparents, I mean, you have your own little thing, nah, nah, papa, whatever. You know, but we love to hear that, don't we? It's like music to our ears. And we like to get them to say it again, right? Da-da, mama, many times. You know, maybe the Father heart of God is very much like that, loves to hear his name. Galatians 4:6 suggests that. Look at what it says. Because you are sons, and implied daughters, God sent the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, the Spirit who calls out from within you, Abba, Father. So it's like the Holy Spirit of God that dwells inside of us is yearning to just declare, Abba, Father. It's pretty cool. There's another reason, though, why it's important to know and to confess the names of the Lord. The names of God that are given to us in Scripture were not like a human invention. They weren't made up by Moses and David and the prophets and the apostles. They were given by God himself. Divine revelation. These are the names that God chose to do what? To reveal his character to us. All of the names of God the Father, of Jesus, of the Holy Spirit are like a composite revelation of God's nature, of God's ways, of God's identity. They're trying to give us another glimpse into who he is. They tell us more about who God is just in the same way that we use our names to know who we are. I mean, imagine trying to go through life without having a name. If we want to get to know God, we need to get to know the names of God. If you want to get to know God, you have to get to know his names. Let me say a little bit more about what this has to do with our worship. The names of God are evidence that God wants to enter in more fully into an intimate relationship with us and us with him. For example, if I want you to know me more, maybe we're just getting introduced or getting acquainted, you know, I'll tell you not only my name is Paul, I'll say, well, my last name is Burmeister. It's a good German name. Jawohl. Comes from the Meister of the Burg, the mayor of the village. So I have a little bit of royal blood in me. I don't know, maybe I'm just a farmer, I'm not sure, but you know, I would want you to know that about me, and maybe I would want you to know my middle name, which I don't tell very many people, but I'll let you in on it this morning. Irwin, Paul Irwin, comes from my maternal grandmother's maiden name, and you might know that that's not German, that's actually English, so I'm at least a quarter English. But if I wanted you to know even more about me, if I was willing to reveal that and divulge that and tell you something that maybe only my wife or my closest friends know about me, I might tell you some of my nicknames. And some of them, well, I'm not going to tell you my nicknames. Maybe someday, but not, you know, you would laugh, right? But all of that would be like peeling back the layers of an onion or something, peeling back the layers so that we know more and more and more of this person. Who's the real man? Who's the real person? Here's the thing. The revelation of the names exposes the heart. The revelation of the names exposes the person. And that's what God is doing. 117 names for Jesus in the Bible. Why? And God wants us to know Jesus. He's given us more than a dozen names for the Father and for the Holy Spirit. As an appendix to his book, Experiencing God, Dr. Henry Blackaby actually developed a list of all the names and the titles and the descriptions of God that are to be found in the Bible. And I actually made like 30 copies of this. They're at the Welcome Center. It's a really great study. I would encourage you to take one of these and to look through it and pray through it and look at the scriptures and let it guide you so that you get to know this God a little bit better. The question is, why would God give us so many names and titles for himself? Well, here's why. It's because he wants us to know him completely. And we know when we get to heaven, we will. We'll see him face to face. The veil will be removed, we'll be made like him in his glory, we'll know God fully, but he wants us to experience that here and now. I mean, why wait till you get to heaven? You don't have to. And God does that. He wants us to know him more fully so that, here's the connection, so that we can worship him more completely, so that we can acknowledge him in worship. Lamb of God, bright and morning star, the branch, the Alpha and the Omega. I mean, he is all of those. And he can hear those names and say, yeah, that's what I am. There's more to it than that, though. If you turn with me to Malachi, last book in the Old Testament, right before Matthew, Malachi chapter 1. I want to read these verses, but before I do, let me give you just a little bit of background here. God's concern in the time of the prophet Malachi was their neglect of the worship of God. So this is a very germane passage to this series that we're in right now. They were neglecting the worship of God. The priests had become lazy and complacent about worship. They had actually corrupted the altar and the whole sacrificial system, allowing people to bring unblemished sacrifices, and we'll hear some of that in the text. So let's read starting at verse 10 of chapter 1. Oh, that one of you would shut the temple doors so that you would not light useless fires on my altar. Wow. It's like, just close the doors of the church. I don't even want you in there. That's pretty strong. I'm not pleased with you, says the Lord Almighty, and I will accept no offering from your hands. My name will be great among the nations, from the rising to the setting of the sun. In every place, incense and pure offerings will be brought to my name, because my name will be great among the nations, says the Lord Almighty. But you profane it by saying of the Lord's table, it's defiled, and of its food, it's contemptible. And you say, what a burden, and you sniff at it contemptuously, says the Lord Almighty. When you bring injured, crippled, or diseased animals and offer them as sacrifices, should I accept them from your hands? Says the Lord. Cursed is the cheat who has an acceptable male in his flock and vows to give it, but then sacrifices a blemished animal to the Lord. For I am a great king, says the Lord Almighty, and my name is to be feared among the nations. And that last verse, and verse 11 especially, point us to a theme that runs like a river through the whole Old Testament, and that is that the Jews were supposed to be bearers of the name, that they were a light to the Gentiles, that God chose his people to reveal himself to the rest of the world. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all of their descendants, they were set apart for one purpose, and that is to bear the name of Yahweh to the rest of the world. Name bearers. And today, those of us who call ourselves Christian are to bear the name of Christ. We're to bring not only the name, we're supposed to bring the person of Jesus to a lost, broken, dying world. That's our commission. We're probably all familiar with the Olympic Games. They're coming to London, England, I think, this summer, if I remember right. You're probably aware of this tradition that has a torch being carried into the stadium to light the Olympic flame at the opening ceremonies. That torch is representative of the brotherhood of man, so I'm told, and the spirit of sport and competition that unites all men in the common pursuit of excellence, unquote. The Olympic torch points to that human spirit that transcends our national boundaries, our racial barriers, all of our other divisions. I mean, it transcends language, culture, custom, ideology, you name it. And the individuals that are chosen to bear the torch, remember how when we had it here in the United States, they had people running all through the country carrying the torch, you know, until finally on opening day, some lucky dude or gal got to bring the torch into the stadium and, you know, light the big one. And they talk about what an honor, I mean, what a privilege, what a sacred duty it is to be able to carry that torch just for a few minutes. It's like the biggest deal in their life. And I think about that and I think, well, that's just for the glory of man, for the glory of some athletes. You and I are torch bearers. Moreover, we are name bearers, the name of Jesus, for the glory of God, Not for our glory, not to us, O Lord, not to us, Psalm 115:1, but to thy name be the glory. And we bear the name, the glorious name of Jesus. It's amazing. Look at Revelation 3:12. I'll put the verse up on the screen. Well, actually, I won't. Aaron will. Thank you, Aaron. Jesus makes an incredible statement here. He who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Now, that doesn't mean like a pillar of salt, like Lot's wife, or, you know. Never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from God, and I will also write on him my new name. So you are getting three new names when you get to heaven. You're going to get the name of my God, you're going to get the name of the city of the God, and you're going to get a new name that the Lord only knows. That was actually prophesied 8 centuries before John wrote those words. Isaiah 62, verse 2 says, "The nations will see your righteousness and kings your glory. You will be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will bestow." So if you know God this morning by faith in his Son, Jesus Christ, God is waiting to give you these new names when you get to heaven. It's going to be pretty amazing. Don't you wonder what your new name is going to be? I kind of like Paul. It's short. It's sweet. At least I think so. But if you're not certain of your relationship to God this morning, God is waiting not only to give you a new name, he's waiting to give you a new nature, to make you a new person. I mean, do you ever find yourself thinking or maybe even saying, I despise myself. I despise my life. I hate my life and the mess that I have made of it. You know, God doesn't hate you. God doesn't despise you. God loves you. And you should never despise what God says he loves. If God doesn't despise you, why should you? God wants you to turn your life to him this morning so he can make it what he knows it needs to be. And I came across an interesting poster in my research this week. Take a look at this poster. God, it is not his name, it's my opinion of him. I don't know what you think of that. I say it is his name. And hopefully it's not just your opinion of him. Hopefully it is your belief in him. It is your confession of him. It is your declaration to the world of that's who he is. There is none beside him, no one more worthy of worship. I look at what Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:15. And he, meaning Jesus Christ, died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again. And then he goes on to say a very familiar verse, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they're a new person, they're a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. Only Christ can do that for you. And so Paul goes on to close that chapter 5 by saying, we implore you on God's behalf, be reconciled to God. Be reconciled to God. Do you need to do that this morning? To be reconciled to him? Are you out of fellowship with God? You know, you can't worship him the way he needs to be worshiped, should be worshiped, if you don't know him. God's desire and his intention for your life from before you were even born is that from the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord should be praised through you. That's your purpose. God's purpose for your life is that the name of the Lord be praised through you. But you can't get there. That's not going to happen if you don't know Jesus personally. Being a church member isn't going to make that happen. Getting baptized is not going to make that happen. Having your name on the rolls of a church or carrying a big Bible or giving money to the church is not going to make it happen. Only knowing Jesus is what will make it happen. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue confess. He is Lord. Do you know him as your Lord this morning? If you don't, God is saying, it's so easy. Just ask. Just ask. Just pray from your heart and say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. In fact, let's go to the back of our bulletin this morning. I think I've got my bulletin up here. Let's turn to the back panel, inside back panel. And I think we should just pray this aloud together. And let's just pause, though, because I want you to just do a real fearless, heart-searching inventory of where you're at with Christ this morning. You know, it's not knowing about Jesus, it's knowing Jesus, and there is a difference. You can know a lot about Jesus, and when Judgment Day comes and you stand before him, there will be people, according to Matthew 25, where he says, I never knew you, depart from me. I never knew you. You don't want to be one of those people. This is a prayer that if you mean this from your heart will change everything. It will change your eternal destiny. It will change your life now and forever. Because the Holy Spirit of God is going to come and dwell in you and begin to change things and bring life, bring joy, bring peace, bring hope. So let's pray this together. We're going to just pray the words that are in bold print right in the middle of the page there. Let's begin. God, I come to you in Jesus' name. I believe that Jesus died on the cross and that by shedding his blood, he paid for my sins. I receive your forgiveness for all of my sins, past, present, and future. I believe that Jesus rose from the dead, and I now surrender to him as the Lord of my life. I'm not going to live to please myself any longer. I want to live for Jesus every day. So Jesus, take me. I am yours now and forever. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have heard my prayer. My past is gone. My sins are washed away. And I am your child on my way to heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.